ranch them in the pasture, run them in the pen, work them on the Sundays, do it all again. Race them in the sand, buck them in the mud, drip a cowboy's sweat, bleed a cowboy's blood.
I'm Zeke Thurston, 2016 World Champion Saddlebrock Rider, and you're watching the Peppert Stewart Show.
What? What did he say? Did he say you're watching this? Why did he do that? Why did he let you know? But you're here. You're here. I am here. Is there no one else? Is there no one? No, no one else. No one else here. Just me today. But that changes from time to time as folks do rotate in here to conversate with me. Welcoming you all here because some of you guys have been here for a while. And some of you guys are like, wait, what is this? Where am I looking at? Where am I at? What is happening? It's good stuff. You tuned in to the right place for some ranch rodeo and randomness for you. That's what happens here. That's what happens here. Just 1 hour. Just 1 hour a day it happens, but it happens. And this is where it goes. So if you're new here, glad you're here. If you've been here for a while, well, why? But it's going to be a good time. We're going to have a good time today. We always do that. We always have a good time, no matter who's here. But today, I'm here. I'm not Dr. Seuss. We got some guests today. We got some good guests today that's going to hop on in here that we're going to talk to. We got that. We got stuff going down in Cowtown. We're going to tell you about that. We got some good rodeo news for you, some odd news for you, which is everyone's favorite. We got some goats. Man, we got some goats in there. Entertainment's going to happen. We got some Yellowstone stuff, some 1883 stuff going on. Where was I at this week? I stumbled into, because as you know, I'm doing some different things. I'm going and doing a little bit of traveling, different places, different things, and experiencing different things. And so that's what I've been doing. Just like I went to Cisco, to the Hilton Hotel, over in Cisco. This is actually first ever Hilton Hotel. Now you're looking at the picture like, wait, it says Mobley. Yes, there's a reason it says Mobley, but it was the first ever Hilton Hotel right there. Even Paris Hilton herself has been there. I'll tell you about that. I went out there and did a story. We got a story coming up that we're going to get to probably in a couple of episodes on the place, on the Hilton Hotel, the history of it, and what's going on out there, and how it all transpired. So for a little bit of backstory for you guys, this is what happened. Conrad Hilton, back in the 1900s, was a banker. Okay, he was a banker. That's what he did. He came to Cisco, Texas, because back in the 1900s, it was a booming town. A lot of stuff was happening. A lot of stuff was going on. The railroad was blowing up. As they always say in the old days, the railroad coming through, it did. And Cisco, that's what's happening. So little Conrad Hilton rode the train and was like, man, you got like three or four banks in this town. I'm a banker. I'm going to buy one. So he went to town, went to all the banks. He's like, hey, I want to buy you out. They laughed at him. He's like, nope, not going to happen. So he's like, well, I need somewhere to stay. So he went to the Mobley, which at the time was only 3 years old. So he went to the Mobley Hotel, spent the night, got to talking. He's like, hey, you know what? How about I just buy your hotel? And he did. And that right there was the first ever Hilton Hotel right there in Cisco, Texas. So if you're out and about going that way, stop in, check it out, because there is a museum on the second floor. We got a lot of footage from that. And we even stayed the night and did a ghost hunt, or ghost watch, as I like to say. And some crazy stuff happened, and we got it on video. We got it on video, because if it wasn't on tape, you wouldn't have believed it, so we got it. So, yeah, if you're out in that way, go check it out and stop in. It's not a hotel anymore, but they've got a couple of rooms set up like the hotel so you can look at. And there's a museum on the second floor with a lot of good historic information in there. So be sure and head out to Cisco, Texas, check it out. Like I say, we got a lot of footage from that. We're working on a story to put together for you guys to show you. It may be a couple of weeks, a month or so before we get that together, but it's going to be some good stuff. It's going to be entertaining. And the only little tidbit that I will give you from that, other than the Santa Claus hanging murder, is that was the first hotel that had a restaurant in it. Because when the guys came in from working out in the fields, in the oil fields out there, they'd get back to the hotel to stay, and they're hungry. And old Conrad Hill was like, well, why don't we just have a little restaurant and feed these guys? So that is where the first restaurant in a hotel happened. It was right there. So anyway, check it out. Look it up. It is a great historic location to see. There's other stuff in Cisco you can check out. They've got some breweries, since that's all the rage now. Everybody wants to go to a brewery and try breweries. Muddy Mike's, I eat there when I go out there. I've been out there a few times. And I go to Muddy Mike's Bar and Grill. They've got some great food over there. So be there and eat while you're in town. And, I mean, just stop and look it up. Check it out. What else you going to do? You going to go to the PBR? 2024 PBR is going to be some good stuff. So you're going to want to watch it. Do it. PBR action's happening. You're going to want to watch it. You're going to want to watch some PBR. Professional bull riders at your service. Watch it up. What else we got going on is guests. I did tell you we had guests, didn't I? I was not fooling, as they say. Chris Petersen is a cowboy singer. He sings cowboy songs, horse songs. He's got a pretty good song I don't want to say it's funny because it's true. I mean, it's true. What he's singing about is true, and he's singing about horse people. And I heard the song, and I was like, wait a minute. He's talking about me. So anyway, it's pretty good stuff. And we've got somebody from Yellowstone. We have Yellowstone folks in here every now and again. We've got another one coming in who took the internet by storm for making this magical concoction.
Gator.
Yeah.
Would you mind making me a smoothie, please?
Sure, what kind of smoothie?
2 scoops of ice cream, 3 shots of vodka.
For smoothie, Miss Beth.
Bless you.
That's right. Gator, the man himself, we're going to talk to him after a while. He is the chef of chefs, and he's got a cookbook out. So we're going to talk to him about that and see what's going on with him. It's got to be good stuff. It's got to be good stuff that he's cooking out there. We ran into him last year at the Careity Foundation where he was competing in that out there, so that's pretty good. We'll get into that here a little bit later. But I was talking about horse people, and I was telling you about the song. I was like, man, are you talking about me or what? So anyway, I want you guys to check out this tune and see if he's talking to you.
Horse people, they're just a little different than most people. Bow-legged boots, stomping stall muckers. Tired and tuckered, going broke, trying to feed a bunch of four-legged buckers. Horse people, God bless them, they're addicted like a junkie to a needle. And I've discovered that most of them like horses more than they like people.
All right, what is that, and what is going on with that? Chris, are you there with us?
I'm here.
Man, what are you talking about me for?
Yeah, right? Talking about myself a little bit too, I guess.
I was like, man, what in the world is going on with that? So so where are you at? You got the flat hat, so what part of the country are you in?
I'm in Utah.
Aha. Okay. I always see, especially on TikTok and stuff, you always see the big controversies with the different hats. Everybody, he got a flat hat, he's got a crown on his hat. I'm like, it's all hats, guys. Come on.
I actually, when I came up with this style, I was actually working down in Texas.
Uh-oh.
So I broke the rules, I guess.
Oh, they're probably looking at, what are you doing with that hat, man? So, champion, you were the Country Battle USA champion back in 2019. You did a little stint
on. That's correct.
So, and then you did a stint on America's Got Talent. You got your 2019 album top the charts. So, what's next for you?
We got a bunch of new stuff coming. We just released Horse People, and really enjoyed seeing all the response from that. A lot of my kind of people love that song. So playing that one live has been a blast. All the Horse People show up for that. And here, September 29th, we've got a new one called Ride Away coming out that I wrote with my producer, Trent Willman.
Okay. Yes, I couldn't tell how many people sent me that video when you were talking about the refrigerators and the ivermectin and everybody kept sending me that video. I was like, yeah, that's it. So, you know what? Let me check this out. I'm going to see what's going on with this. So music, when did you decide that, you know, that's what you want to do? You want to pick a guitar and sing?
I started a little bit later than most people do, but I always loved to write, and I ended up just writing a bunch of songs. I had a whole album of songs before I'd ever sing in public, and it just so happened to be heard by Colin Ray, and he contacted us and said, hey, I'd like you to open for us. And I'd never done a show up until that point. So, of course, I agreed to do it. I was scared to death, but I went and did it, and he gave me a lot of encouragement that night. And from then on, I decided, you know what, I love this, and I want to do it.
And it's working out. And now you're singing. So tell us a little bit about your background, your horses, and kind of what you do horseback and stuff like that.
I grew up in a small agricultural community, a little town called Morgan, Utah. We still live in a small agricultural community, and we're trying hard to keep it that way. But I've always loved horses, been obsessed with horses, and just one of my passions for sure. We raise a few cows, but horses are my passion. Sometimes I feel like I have too many, but then again, can you ever have too many?
Yeah, you can't never have too many, and that's my problem right now. I've got too many that are turning two at the same time.
That's right.
I tried to sell some. I was like, you know what? I put them on the internet, tried to sell them, and I've dealt with the 15,000 questions. I was like, no, just forget it. I'm not dealing with you people.
Yeah.
Because I mean, if you list a horse for sale for $500, they come get it. You put a decent price on, they ask 5 million questions. I'm like, man, come look, see what it is. This is what you need. What are you doing? So as far as running cows, working cows, do you do any competing, any competition, anything like that, or ranch work?
I don't do much competing anymore. I used to ride bareback, a little bit of saddle bronc, but now we just raise a few cows and, like I said, a bunch of horses, and just try to enjoy it. Today we were at the stock show with the kids. They're showing sheep.
Sheep showing, man. They'll keep you busy. Them kids will keep you busy, and they'll keep you broke.
That's right. I guess I figured it was a good way for them to start, so we started out with the sheep.
Yeah, that'll keep you going. Out there playing on the road, you've been playing some shows now and doing some stuff. So far in your musical career, where has been your favorite place to play so far?
My absolute favorite place to play is hands down in these small towns, little small town rodeos, because those are my kind of people. I just can't get enough of seeing small town USA and people out there dancing and having a good time. I'll just sit there up on stage and think, we are so lucky to live this lifestyle and have this kind of a life. And that's just what I love. And to have a bunch of horse people out in the crowd singing back to me, there's nothing better than that.
Oh, not at all. So rather big stadiums, you're more county fair go to.
I enjoy the big stuff. We've played a bunch of shows with Ned Ledoux and Randy Houser and a bunch of people like that. And I love those shows. They're a blast. There's tons of energy. We played a venue that was sold out 2 weeks ago in Montana. And I love it. Don't get me wrong. I love it. But you asked what my favorite was. Mm-hmm. My favorite are the small towns.
Small towns. You can't get better than a good small town gathering, sitting out there playing a little music and having a good time.
Yeah.
So on the road when you're out there hitting those towns, who's hauling with you? You taking the family? You taking the band?
Yeah, we We take the whole family. The kids are homeschooled. We load up in the motorhome with my wife and the kids, and we all go. Usually rent the whole, the band has their own van, and we take the motorhome, and we have a good time.
All right, so you got a motorhome full, so that next question is going to be perfect because you got a load. Snacks. What snacks are you packing? Because on the road, it's snack time.
I love snacks. I love salt and vinegar chips, and I love dried mangoes.
Dried mangoes.
Love dried mangoes.
Do they come in a pack? They come in a box? How does that?
Yeah, they come in a big pack. You can go get them at Costco. There's a little plug for Costco, but yeah, dried mangoes. They're like candy. They probably are just pure sugar, but they're delicious.
I'm gonna have to try that. I've had those dried bananas. They make those packets of little dried. I've tried that before. I've never seen the mangoes. I'm gonna check that out. We'll check it out.
You'll have to. Another thing that's popular in Utah is chocolate covered cinnamon bears. Look that one up.
Chocolate covered cinnamon bears.
I don't eat those anymore, but I used to love them.
Huh. I'm gonna look that up. Chocolate covered cinnamon bear. All right. I will check that out. So you run some cattle. What are you running?
I run Simmental, Sim Angus cross, and we've got a couple Jersey dairy cows too.
You gotta have jerseys. You gotta have some of them. Yeah. We keep a Jersey cow out that runs with our black cattle, just extra milk supply.
Yeah, they're my wife's favorite cows too.
We run them out.
They're more like dogs. They got out on the street the other day, and the neighbors called, and they're like, they posted on Facebook, there's a bunch of dogs out there, or a bunch of cows out there that are acting like dogs.
Oh, yeah. That's what everybody, they look at it and go, why is there a Jersey cow out there? Man, that's endless milk supply right there. Some of them first calf heifers, they don't got enough, but that old Jersey load them up.
That's right.
All right, so what do you got coming up? What's your next excursion? Where are you headed to next?
So we've got actually a rodeo show here in St. George, Utah this next weekend. Once again, one of my favorite type of shows, but it's the Dixie Roundup down here in St. George, Utah. And then we've got another one up in Sandy, Utah following that. And then we're actually working on scheduling a Texas tour right now.
Texas tour. Don't come right now. It's too hot. You'll melt. Yeah. You're in Utah. We're going to
wait until it starts to cool down just a little bit. Yeah. We're thinking about January. We're gonna get on the road for that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's too hot. Way too hot for that. So when you played your favorite is your small town, shows. Where is a place that you haven't played yet that you would like to play?
Oh, well, there's a whole lot of places I'd love to play.
What's number one on your list? You said, man, they called me and said, come on.
I think about everybody who wants to play the Billy Bobs.
Billy Bobs, yeah.
That's my number one.
You have to hit that while you're down here.
That's, yeah, that'd be fun.
Get you in down there. That'd be good stuff for you. So the folks are looking for you, trying to figure out where you're at. They want to check out your music. They want to finish up on that Horse People song and what you got coming out. Where's the best place for people to find you?
So my biggest account is on Instagram at diehardcowboy_. You can follow us there. As far as the music goes, we're on all the streaming platforms and you can find it out there.
All right.
But also, yeah, any of the social media, we're at diehardcowboy_. Facebook is just diehardcowboy.
All right. All right. Well, I appreciate you visiting with us. Before we get out of here, is there anything you want to throw out there to your fans or to your future fans?
I always say this at the end of my shows, and I can't do this without the fans, without the people out there listening. So if you're a horse person or you like my music, I would appreciate if you know anybody who organizes events or rodeos or county fairs or stadiums or whatever, I'd appreciate it if you drop my name, Chris Petersen, and we just appreciate it in advance.
All right. We appreciate you taking time to visit with us, and we'll let the folks know. And good luck on your tour. Maybe we'll catch you down here in Texas.
Hey, thank you so much. Look forward to it.
Thank you. All right. That was Chris Petersen. That's a good song. Do you have the YouTube version of that?
Yeah.
Throw that one up right quick. I want to let the folks hear that while we take a pause for the cause. Mm-hmm. Yeah, look him up on the internet. He's got some good tunes out there. You're gonna want to you're gonna listen.
Any crowd, they dress the part and wear it proud. Sometimes you can even smell them. They got dirt and mud and other crap clinging to their boots and hats, and dogs riding in the truck with them. They're always stacking hay and changing tires, fixing things with baling wire and overhauling overused tags. And every single thing on the place is dead, broke, or broken. Everything they own's for sale for cash. Horse people, they're just a little different than most people. Bow-legged boots, stomping stall muckers, tired and tuckered, going broke, trying to feed a bunch of four-legged buckers. Horse people, God bless them, they're addicted like a junkie to a needle. And I've discovered that most of them like horses more than they like people. There's nothing in their fridge they eat is full of butane, penicillin, and ivermectin. They live on Burger King and Taco Bell. The dash is loaded down with bills from farriers and veterinarians. And they can tell you every pedigree of every single steed they ever bought, sold, trained, or traded. Oh, and none of them are full of bull or slightly egotistical or overly opinionated. Horse people, they're just a little different than most people. Bow-legged boots, stomping stall muckers, tired and tuckered, going broke, trying to feed a bunch of four-legged buckers. Horse people, God bless them, they're addicted like a junkie to a needle. And I've discovered that most of them like horses more than they like people.
See, one time at the Palace Hotel in San Francisco, my eye fell out in a bowl of soup. Got a spoon, put it in my mouth, washed it off, put it back in, and Lois was embarrassed, but didn't bother me. Oh, we're back. I'm just reading this book. Phil Statler. You gotta check this book out. I made a lot of tracks. If you don't know who Phil Statler is, Statler, you're missing out. I posted a picture of him knocking out Slim Pickens at the rodeo. Happened years ago. This was, I guess, a month or so ago. It came up. Somebody at a PRCA rodeo got caught on camera smacking somebody, so everybody got all upset. And I was like, well, it's not the first time it happened. So I posted that. And I got this book. It's called I Made a Lot of Tracks, and it's with Phil Statler. And there's a ton of stuff in this book, guys. The people he met, the places he's been. And one day, when I finish this, I marked a lot of spots. When I finish this, I'll get more in depth to it. I mean, you know, back in his first trip to Mexico in 1939, he was 19 years old, took a train from Turlock to Tucson, cost $26. Showed up. Al Capone was there. So, I mean, there's some crazy stuff. He did not get drafted into the military for a reason. I guess I could tell you maybe. I could tell you that. But anyway, when I get done with this book, I'm going to have a lot to talk about. But it's if you need to find this book on your own, it's called I Made a Lot of Tracks. And it's a good book. You cannot put it down when you start reading it. That's what I was reading right now. In between breaks. All right, so we knocked that out. Chris Peterson, that song, man, that song is good. That's some good stuff. Where are we at now? What do we need to get to talk about stuff? The Net Bio Cattleman's Cook-Off is coming up over in Sulphur Springs. The Net Bio Cattleman's Cook-Off, they have a cook-off every year over there, and they have an artist that comes out and plays some tunes for you. So you want to check that out. If you're a cooker, you're a steak cooker, you want to enter in the competition, you can enter up, whether you're an adult, whether you're adult classes, junior classes. The teams get set up in the morning. They have a cooker's meeting. They go through the beef. All the beef is supplied to you to cook, and it's judged by the judges. And it's an all-day deal, and it rounds out. They're going to have, you know, they'll have judging, they'll have awards, and there'll be a concert at the end. So you're going to want to check that out. I'm not sure who's playing yet. It may be announced already. I'll have to look it up and see. But that's in Sulphur Springs, Texas. So be sure and check out the Cattleman's Cook-Off. What else we got going on? Careity Foundation. The Careity Foundation has set the date for this year's event over in Fort Worth. Careity Foundation, helping with cancer patients. They do free. They got a free mammogram deal they set up and stuff that's going on. They do all the time. They help patients with patient stuff. What is that? And this year it's going to be Yellowstone, 1883, and more at the event on December. So be sure and check it out. It's going to be Friday, December the 1st in Fort Worth at Will Rogers. That's where it will be. They help out with, you know, once you've been diagnosed or a mammogram, they do cancer navigation, navigate things, they help with nutrition, and, man, they do a lot, and, you know, Nicole and Taylor Sheridan are the honorary chairs of this event, so they also help out by bringing in some of the cast that volunteer to come down and compete. And if you've been watching this show for the last, I don't know how many years, you would see that. I do the interviews for Careity for the event, and I do the interviews for Careity. I give, and then I bring those back for you guys to see as well, to see what transpired. Because it's one thing to see them guys on TV pretending to be cowboys, but when you get to see them on a cutting horse, actually cutting and working on a horse, it's good stuff. And a lot of those guys have been there throughout the year. So you can get tickets now if you want to go. It is December the 1st, so you want to do that. Check it out. Speaking of other tickets on sale, Fort Worth Stock Show and Rodeo tickets go on sale in a couple weeks. Fort Worth, Texas Stock Show and Rodeo, they'll be going on sale, and you're going to check that out. Let's do some odd news. Let's do... Man, there is a story you gave me a minute ago. Let me look at this. I think it's a bear or something. I don't know. Let's see what we got here. I think there's even a... I think the news sent us a video for this, too. Let's see. So a three-legged bear broke into a house and drank three White Claws from the refrigerator. A three-legged bear drinking White Claw. That is a Friday night on Cedar Springs. Maybe a Saturday, too. I've seen it happen. Old Tex was even accused of being a bear at one time. So what we got here? We got a... Oh, no, it's a real bear. We got a video of this? We got a video. The news sent us a video. Let's check this out. He ate the fish food that they had by the fish tank. Then he went to the bar, drank some White Claws, and left.
A Lake Mary family had an unexpected guest this Labor Day weekend. A bear. The family's 13-year-old son and their security system caught the whole thing on camera. Westview's Haley Crumbleholme spoke with him about how the bear got into their screened-in patio and helped himself to some White Claws.
Oh my God. I've never been this close to a bear.
13-year-old Joseph Diglio was watching TV Sunday. Barking from the family's dog, Bruno clued him in there was something outside.
Oh my God, there's a literal bear in our patio.
This is the hole the bear ripped open to get inside. And once
he went over here to the fridge and got two white claws.
Mango and strawberry, in case you were wondering.
Oh, look, he just opened the door. He's about to take the beer. He's about to take the beer.
And while the bear's ability to open the fridge was pretty cool, it was also kind of concerning.
Well, once I saw him open the fridge, I got scared that he could open the doors to, like, the houses.
I feel like I gotta lock all the doors now. Oh, my God. Okay, I gotta go lock up my dog.
But it was ultimately barks from Bruno that scared the bear away.
Just part living where we live, honestly.
In Seminole County, Haley Crumpleholm, West 2 News.
Man, those bears. He ripped a hole in that screen. But it ain't the first hole he's ripped. You gotta be careful of them things, man. They will get after you. Bears. We should have asked Chris up on Utah if they have bears up there. But, yeah, I'll pass. I will pass on the bears. We got a little time left. Let's see. We got some goats. We got goat stories. Everybody likes a good goat story. And we're not talking about sports. There was a loose goat. Up in Canada, there was a goat on the loose. Police in Ontario are trying to find the owner of a pair of bad goats. They rounded up after chasing joggers on the eastern part of Province. The Ontario Provincial Police said on social media, officers in Granville are looking for assistance with locating the owner of these two bad goats. The post included a picture of the... if you took a picture of the goats that close, why didn't you just get them? Or rope them. You could have roped those goats. Ain't ever been to a goat roping? You should just rope those goats. Yeah, so the goat puns ensued. So that's what they did. It probably wasn't too bad. What else we got? We got some more goats. We'll do that momentarily because, as we said, we've got another guest for you guys today. I had a chance to catch up with him last year while he was horseback, I believe, and I asked him about about being at the event, what it was like to be at the event, and also what he liked to cook. So let's see what happened with that, and then we're going to talk to him.
And it's a real honor. I was just happy to be invited, and to be included in something like this for me is, you know, I usually don't get out of the kitchen. I'm pretty much stuck in there. So this is really cool, and be back on a horse for the first time in a long time. And the group of people that's here is so great. Everybody's so wonderful and polite, and I'm just so happy to be here. It's been a wonderful night. Man, that's tough. You know, I cooked a lot of 4/6 steers last year, and that had to take the win. Doing a whole cow is so unusual. So many people don't do it, and to just be able to have that meat, that quality meat from the 4/6, is, you cannot beat that. It's so awesome, you know?
Put your hand down.
That's him right there. The man behind the skillet. That's the Gator. Gator, what is going on?
How's it going, man?
Man, it's doing good. It's doing good. So what part of the country have you found yourself in now?
Actually, since the last time I saw you, I moved to Weatherford, Texas, my friend.
Weatherford. All right.
Yeah. Figure there's a lot worse places you could end up than Texas. So
yeah,
I've been having a nice time. It is blistering hot out there today, though.
Oh man, we got about another month of it to cool off a little bit.
Yeah, we had a couple nice days there too, but we're paying for it. So
yeah, yeah, I seen you're out riding your boat. So you got your boat going. You're out there hitting the lake.
Oh yeah, man, I got the full spread over here, and I haven't made a ton of younger friends here in this part of Texas yet, but I enjoy just going out with my dog on the boat and just cruising around. We go to Lake Granbury, Lake Possum Kingdom, and all that.
Okay. I envy you right now because my hydraulic steering is out in my boat. It's going to be another 2-3 weeks before they get it fixed, so I'm just watching everybody else on the lake. Well,
don't worry. We get an extra, extra, extra long summer here in Texas.
Right. So let's dive into this, movie stuff. So, you've been in, I guess I'd say, the movie business for a while, but mostly in the, I guess, the catering side of it?
About 15 years now. I've been running concessions and catering for film and television productions. Most of my work was done down in New Orleans, Baton Rouge area. And around like 2015, 14 or something like that, I started traveling a lot for work and get some bigger shows and made a nice reputation for myself across the industry.
And how did the meeting per se come about with working with Taylor Sheridan?
This wild rodeo we call Yellowstone?
Yes.
I got a phone call in the middle of the night, and I had kind of had a few hints that they were talking about maybe me coming up there, and they had already started the show. They were a few weeks in, and Yellowstone from the get-go and still to this day is one of the hardest TV shows to make. It's brutal. It's real. We're out there in the sticks, and we're the wind. I mean, you know, Texas is, it's just like a warmer version of Montana.
Yeah.
They were really having trouble getting the right fit for what I do on the job. And so I got a phone call at midnight one night, and I was working on a show there in New Orleans, and they asked me, hey, so do you want to come to Utah and come work on this TV show? And I said, well, yeah, of course. Get me out of this New Orleans heat. It was like, you know, middle of the summer. So
yeah.
Get me out of here, please.
Right.
And they said, great. Can you leave right now? And I said, that's absurd. I could not possibly leave right now. I'm on set. I'm working right now. Well, when can you leave? And I said, well, I'll leave in the morning. They gave me very little information, not that I really needed it. And, they told me about this guy that was their director that was very hungry and angry. he was hangry.
Yeah.
And they said, all we need you to do is come out here and feed this guy, please. Just somebody has to appease Taylor Sheridan. And I had no idea who, you know, he was. I had seen some of his movies, but I'd never put it all together. And that was the only instruction I got, was feed Taylor Sheridan. And I drove straight through the day and the night in my old beat up tool truck conversion into a kitchen. And I drove all the way to Utah and met a guy in a parking lot with a big envelope full of cash. And and I started Yellowstone. I prepped in a Walmart parking lot, opened up all my kitchen and pulled all the carts out. And me and one other guy, we shop, you know, I drove up there completely empty. So we shop, got drinks, coffee and all that stuff. And I brewed me a pot of coffee in the Walmart parking lot at about 4 a.m. and then drove to the set of Yellowstone, and the rest is history, you know?
Yeah. And so now once you got up there, you were cooking for everybody. At what point did they realize in the big house, we got to have somebody cooking in the house because we're the Duttons. We can't cook. We got to have somebody that cooks. So what happened with that transition from cooking on the outside to cooking on the inside?
I can tell you this. I know that Taylor Sheridan always has a plan. Whether people like to believe it or like his method, that's up to them. But he always knows what he's doing. And I think I'd like to think that he had a plan for that the whole time. And just the fact that he met me and I was a really good fit for the show, and me and Yellowstone just made sense. You know, we were, I was on the Yellowstone program right away. So I'd like to think that he always knew that there was going to be a cook for sure. Mm-hmm. And Taylor's very, he's a big foodie, and he's really adamant about feeding everybody and feeding the crew. And it just so happened that I was there at the right time and I was the right guy for it. And I ain't a chicken either. So when he told me to go do it, I wasn't going to back down, you know?
Yeah. All right. So from being on there serving up the dishes, I think the biggest media storm we've seen from all the dishes you cooked wasn't even food. It was a smoothie.
Oh, it was the dang smoothie. Yeah.
A smoothie.
It's in here. It's in the book. It's in the one book. Of the last ones in there. And I wouldn't recommend drinking two of them either. It'll put you on your ass pretty quick. So.
Yeah. Oh man. So tell me about the book. You got the cookbook out, and then you're also working with.
I'm actually surrounded by cookbooks right now. They're all over my house.
Everywhere.
I'm signing a bunch for all of our cast members, and we'll send them out to them.
Okay. So when did that idea come about? He's like, man, I'm cooking all this stuff. Yellowstone cookbook. Everybody likes Yellowstone. Let's send them a book.
It was something that had been talked about for a while, even before Yellowstone for me, that I started to develop a pretty nice base of recipes and dishes that I made often and were recurring successes. And I had a lot of friends and family. They would reach out to me asking about, you know, oh, how do I cook this? How do I smoke this? And, you know, honestly, got just here, just by the book. and one of our producers, the head of 101 Studios that makes Yellowstone, David, came to me one day, and I'm very fortunate to be on good terms and buddies with all those guys, which is real nice. And he came to me one day and he said, so we're going to do a cookbook. And obviously, you, as you probably know, Yellowstone's launched a huge merchandise mm-hmm. campaign that we've got seasonings, and we're going to have pre-cooked food and jerkies and of course a million other pieces of swag, if you will, that we call them. And he said, we're going to do a cookbook. Would you be interested in authoring the cookbook? And I said, well, now, David, wouldn't that be weird if I didn't author that cookbook? Yeah. And he goes, yeah, that would be weird. And I said, yeah, I'll do the cookbook, man. And we jumped in pretty quick working on it. It's been over a year now that we've been working on it. It's finally coming out. And it was a pretty big undertaking for me to literally put pen to paper from stuff that I've been doing for years by touch and by smell and taste. And very rarely measuring, and anybody that knows me will tell you this, Gator don't measure nothing, just add butter.
Yeah.
And so it was a new experience for me to actually pull that stuff out of my head and put it down on a piece of paper, measurements and serving sizes. And you know, Yellowstone, we don't judge people based on their serving sizes. We give them a full dose every time.
Right. And that's the other thing that something else they brought up. They said, man, you cook all these great meals, they never eat it. They never get to eat.
Well, worry not, my friend. They are eating behind the scenes, and they are eating professionally. They don't, there's not a lot of shame up there in Montana. You know, we don't report back to the cities or the Hollywood. Right. You can eat meat and butter and gluten, and I ain't going to tell none of your friends back in LA.
Oh man, that works. So you got the book tour coming out. You're going to be here in I think you're heading to New Jersey, and then you're going to be here in Dallas.
I'll be there in Dallas. Yeah. I don't have my schedule here, but I'll be there.
Right. There it is. Like, so you got New Jersey, yeah, September 11th. September 11th, you got New Jersey, 13th in Dallas, then Los Angeles, Orlando, Austin, Boise, and Salt Lake City, Utah.
Yeah, as my good friend Michael Berry says, all the liberal cities.
So you're gonna be here next week. Dang, that's 6 o'clock. It's late. I may have to drive over there anyway because I need to cook some.
Well,
stuff.
I might have some extra time in the early part of the day if you want to get together and do something.
Yeah. I'm gonna hit you up, and take you up on that and do it. All right. Before we get out of here, the cookbook's out. You also kind of helped out or partnered in with, I guess, with the season. The Yellowstone seasonings are out. And
yeah, we're gonna start pushing the seasonings real hard. I'm gonna do some ads for them and a lot of social media stuff and some different recipes. Sorry, my dog's yelling at me.
All right.
So we're going to do a bunch of stuff with the Yellowstone foods. It's a really nice line of products. Some of the jerkies are super, super good. They got some Wagyu beef sticks that are nice. Some canned products and the seasonings came out real nice too.
All right. Well, I'll tell you what, before we get out of here, I know you're a busy man. You got a ton of books to sign. Your hands going to be wore out.
Just don't make me go outside right now. It's still hotter than heck out there. So
keep them inside. People looking for the cookbook, where do we send them to order?
Anywhere where you can buy books. It's going to be available as soon as it releases in a few days. But right now you can pre-order on Amazon and anywhere else online that you buy books. It'll be there. I believe we're going to be in Costco and Sam's Club as well. You'll be seeing it around. And it came out really nice. It's visually beautiful. There's some great pictures in there. There's some never before published photos from the set of some of our cast. It came out as a real nice coffee table book too. The finish is nice, and it'll look good sitting on your counter or on your coffee table. It really is beautiful. And I kept all the recipes in there. Most of them are stuff that I've been cooking for years for the cast and crew of all of my shows, and especially Yellowstone. Mm-hmm. There's some that you'll recognize from the show, but also a lot of it is just things that got me through the last decade or so of feeding movie crews that were tried and true and relatively easy to pull off, and they could be made on a large scale. So anybody that's cooking for a big group, or if you got a big family, or if you just kind of don't know what the heck you're doing in the kitchen, like I most of the time don't, it's really everything's in there is simple. And I like to think of it as recipes that your grandparents would be proud of, you know?
Okay. All right. Well, we will sure do that. When you get down to Austin, you need to pass them out down there to Austin a lot. I was working on the show down there this last year, and the food was terrible.
They need more butter in their lives.
They need something besides carrot sticks. So coming up.
Yeah, you ain't wrong.
I'm telling you. So coming up, we talked about it earlier before we got you on. Careity released their date for December. Have you got any word yet? You're going to be competing in this deal again in Fort Worth?
I would just like to practice a little bit more this time before I go out there and make a fool of myself. And I will wear spurs this time too, because I got a lot of flack for not wearing spurs out there. And I would absolutely love to go do that again. And it was a real blast. And again, practice would be nice though.
Yeah,
I came in real blind on that, and I had been on a horse in at least a decade. Yeah. So it was, all I could hear was Jake Ream yelling behind me, put your hand down, put your hand. It was really fun, but it was intense.
Yeah. We caught it on the video. The video.
You tape. Actually have one of the best, clips of that. I don't even have that one. And I don't look as much a fool in that video that you have, thankfully. And I appreciate that.
All right. Well, not a problem, man. I tell you what, we'll let you get back to it. I know you got stuff to do, and I guess we'll we'll see you here in Dallas.
Time, man.
Yep, we'll see you here in Dallas next week.
And I'm always right down the road if you ever want to get together, Pepper.
I'm going to have to get you to show me how to work my smoker. I've been smoking a bunch of meat, and I'm having trouble. So
I think I can help with that, too.
All right, Gator, man, I appreciate it. We'll see you down the road.
All right, good buddy. Thanks for having me on, man.
Thank you. All right, Gator. See, if you had watched the whole clip of the video of me and him at the Careity, I was asking him about cooking. We're talking about meat. I was like, man, I've been smoking this meat and trying to get this to work and that and that. And I'm like, man, it ain't working out for me. But it did work. I finally figured it out. Got my smoker running like I need it to, where I can smoke some meat. But yeah, no, that guy is just he's a fun guy, man. Fun guy. You got Corona over there? They say it's back. They're about to stab everyone again. They're going to stab us all. We're coroned out. What else do we need to talk about? Oh, goats, man. Goats. The goats in Cali. They're going back to Cali. It was weird when I saw this headline about goats escaping in California. Wouldn't sheep be more fitting for California? I mean, I don't know. A California resident's home security camera captured the moment hundreds of escaped goats stampeded through the neighborhood. I don't think they know what that word means because they don't look like they're stampeding. Through the neighborhood late at night, Kristen, who lives in Ring Mountain neighborhood of Court Moderna, shared her Nest Cam showing hundreds of goats passing through her house. The goats were feasting on vegetation in the area and woke up residents and pets with their ruckus, the neighbors said. The goats are contracted by the city to clear vegetation, which I'm glad to know that they are doing this again. I'm very glad to know that that is happening. And then you're asking me, why would I be glad that's happening? Because every year, California burns. They have these big wildfires. This right here is called wildfire prevention. They've done it for hundreds of years. You don't ever remember hearing 100 years ago of California on fire. Why is that? Because they had managed logging and underbrush clearing. If you clear out your underbrush and you log your trees and regrow, which the trees grow back, that's how it works all across all the places where we get trees from, where the trees are harvested. Trees are harvested, then trees are replanted. There, in the meantime, all the underbrush is cleared. So if there is a fire, it doesn't burn the entire state. The reason California has been burning like crazy is for that reason. No one has been taking care of the underbrush, and no one's been logging and replanting because it doesn't fit with the narrative of California. So maybe they got tired of burning their houses down every year and thought, you know what? Those guys that say let the goats out, let's let the goats out. So that will help. I guess I should have talked to them about this. Yellowstone is on CBS's fall lineup. I should have mentioned that to old Gator. And 1883 is on Paramount Network. It was on Paramount Plus, also on Paramount Network because of the big writer's strike. We're not supposed to be talking about movies, but I'm talking about it anyway. Go watch it. 1883 and Yellowstone. I think I did two episodes in both. I was season 5 Yellowstone and two episodes in 1883 where I got to shoot guns. That's always fun. We're going to be giving away some DVDs for 1923 Yellowstone. And some rodeo clothing caps at some point. We'll probably do it on Facebook. So if you go to Pepper Stewart on Facebook, look that up. We're going to be doing that. People won't know where I went. I went to a concert in town, but I don't think we have time for that because we're running up on the clock. So I may have to talk about this concert next time where they were screaming out SpongeBob SquarePants and a metal concert, which that was strange to me. I went to see those people, Ghost, which is I don't know. I noticed that they were in the Woodlands before they came to Dallas, and there was people protesting down there about, you're bringing Satan here, anti-Satan. I'm like, it's some people dressed up in costumes. It's not real life, guys. I know it's the Bible Belt and all, but it's not real life. It's a gimmick. It's called a joke. You ever watch TV before? It's just a bit they do. The dude wears a ghost looking costume, and the band members wear look like they're on Star Wars with the big helmet things. He's got a mask on, and they're playing in the with costume. It's just a show. It's entertainment. Entertainment value. And man, they were protesting about Satan's coming, bringing Satan to our town. Devil worshipers. Like, no, it's just some rock band from, I think they're from Sweden or something like that. They're from another country. And they were here in town, and so I was down the pit. And then they had this opening act right there was a Viking band from somewhere on the other side of the world. I think they were called, the one was called Ghost, and they were called Armin Armirth. And they're Vikings, and they had a big Viking fight. And so there's me filming. I guess I'm like the third person from the stage down in the pit, in the mosh pit. There wasn't no moshing going on, but it was an entertaining show. I mean, it was, the entertainment value was good. They had props and costumes and stuff. And I just, you know, I think if you're going to put on a good show. Entertain the people. I even saw Jesus there. Jesus was even there. I was going to get a picture with him and get him to say a little prayer for Tex, but he ended up being drunk. So I wasn't going to get a video with a drunk Jesus. That would have really helped out the protesters. Jesus is drunk. Like, guys, it's not real Jesus. Because Tex has got problems. I don't know if y'all know. Old Tex used to be on the show for years. He got knocked up with cancer, so he's battling that. Been in the hospital for about a month or two. After about a month of being in the hospital, his wife decided to divorce him. So now he's going through divorce while he's laid up in the hospital with cancer. So, wonderful lady that is. So that's what's going on with him. So go look him up, text Travis on Facebook, shoot him a message over, see how it's going. Man, he's lost a ton of weight. He is so skinny now. He's such a beanpole. But they're working on him. They got the cancer from down the bottom. Then it went up to the stomach. Now it's up in the lungs. So he's having a rough go of it. I guess before I get out of here, we do have a movie trailer for you to check out called it's fixing to come out. It's going to be in theaters, and after theaters, it's going to Netflix. It is after a fateful near miss, an assassin battles his employers and himself on an international manhunt he insists isn't personal. It's called The Killer. Check it out.
Simple.